The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
It's Empty Wheel Friday on the Nicole Sandler Show.
It is. And as soon as I get this going, we will have Marcy Wheeler. Here we go. Ready? Let's go to the videotape, as they say. So it is Friday, and Marcy Wheeler is here. It helps the segue from week into weekend much easier. So Marcy, before we get started, this was another busy week, go figure. Quick check-in, the foot, everything progressing okay?
Yeah, I went to the pool today, second time in the pool. I'm slowly becoming, you know, like I'm slowly able to do laps again. Riding my bike around Limerick, so I'm finally becoming a human being again, which is nice.
Oh, very nice. Yeah, I was going to say, I thought I might need your boot because I thought I broke my foot. But now I'm just waiting to find out if I have gout or not. So
my three boots. I have three boots still, Nicole.
You know, I had two because I've broken, I actually broke the fifth metatarsal bone in each foot at different times over the last decade or so. And when we moved from Florida, I didn't bring the boots. Silly me. I should have thought ahead knowing, yes, we're getting older and these things happen. But
they're probably like $700 in the United States, aren't
yes,
they?
Yeah. Yeah. Especially when you have shitty insurance, which I do. See, I've decided, here's my dilemma. I'm 64. I will be 65 on November 4th, the day before Election Day. So I can't wait to hit 65 because Medicare, bring it on. I've decided they want you to die before you hit 65 here because it's cheaper, right? So they just want to kill you. As I witnessed yesterday when I had to navigate the healthcare system to try to figure out what's going on with my foot. I can't wait for November 4th to get here, but I'm dreading November 5th getting here. It's like the push me, pull you of anticipation.
Maybe November 5th will be a blowout. I mean, I hope so. There's so much that we, it's still so early in what is just going to be a crazy year. So,
yeah. And again, and I've said this before and I'll say it again, I have no doubt that Joe Biden will win the popular vote, will win legitimately, but I don't put it past Donald Trump and his cronies to do everything they can to steal the election, to use their vernacular. So yes, as we've talked about before, it's gonna be a messed up year. So I wanna start with our new word of the week. Our new vocabulary word that we learned this week was mandamus, how do you say it?
I think it's mandamus, but mandamus. I think it's mandamus. Yeah. We've heard it before. I believe that when they challenged Aileen Cannon's stuff, remember Aileen Cannon kind of inserted herself in the search of Donald Trump's stuff and made some. So I believe, if I recall correctly, that was mandamus as well. When Bill Barr's DOJ was trying to reverse the prosecution of Mike Flynn, they usually mandamus is against a judge. And so it's a writ of mandamus against something that the judge badly fucked up. And so they Bill Barr's DOJ used it against Emmett Sullivan, okay, who's a great judge, and didn't succeed there. Whereas if I'm remembering correctly, that they used mandamus against Aileen Cannon in 2022, that did succeed. Whatever they did, it succeeded in the 11th Circuit. We're not anywhere close to where I think Jack Smith thinks he'll succeed with mandamus. It really, really has to be something outside of the ordinary. And what Aileen Cannon is doing is very skillfully kind of playing rope-a-dope with Jack Smith. So she is making a lot of tactical decisions that damage the prosecution against Trump and really delay it so it won't happen before the election. But she's doing so in such a way that there's not an easy appeal. So I'm of the, you know, there's a bunch of theories out there. There are some TV lawyers saying, oh, it's going mandamus today. There's other people saying that they will move to recuse her. And then, which there's no better reason to recuse her than there is for the mandamus. Although the recusal, at least you can point to her past actions. I mean, I think, and I guess I should write this up, but one of the things that's important is, well, let me take a step back. So what happened was, you know, Donald Trump has filed, as all defendants do, a bunch of motions to dismiss the document theft indictment against him. And some of those are normal, and Aileen Cannon is treating them abnormally. For example, many defendants say, you know, this is political. There's no evidence of that in Trump's case, but that argument is going to work with Aileen Cannon because it's Aileen Cannon. It's going to work with the right wing. And, you know, a lot, people make category errors about Trump's legal moves. A lot of what he does is not because he wants to win in court. It's because he's trying to create a political movement with it. And so, you know, that's one that by all rights should fail and probably will, but nevertheless, it feeds the base. Another one that he did was to say, under the Presidential Records Act, I have unreviewable authority while I'm president to turn anything into a personal document. And therefore, anything I put on a truck and ship to Mar-a-Lago, I had turned to a personal document, and therefore I can't have willfully held these documents. Now that Jack Smith last week wrote a response to that notion, and mm-hmm. he was like, look, here's where this entire notion came from. It came from Tom Fitton, who is the head of Judicial Watch. And after it was public that Donald Trump sent documents back in 2022, Tom Fitton went to Mar-a-Lago and said, let me give you a gimmick so that you can steal these documents and get away with it. And Trump liked that theory better than what actual lawyers were telling him. And so he adopted it. But the important part about the theory is that he didn't even hear of Tom Fitton's theory until February of 2022. So he cannot say that this theory that he could just magically make all these documents personal in January of 2021, when his lawyers were telling him something very different and Tom Fitton wasn't hip to this yet, it doesn't work. It's a dumb theory. And also, you know, the Presidential Records Act, and one of the things that, you know, again, Aileen Cannon is very susceptible to this bullshit. Trump's lawyers were like, well, look, you know, Joe Biden brought stuff home, too. And the evidence is nothing similar.
Right.
But of the two things that Robert Hur found at Biden's residence that he thought could be an example of 18 U.S.C. 793, the same charge against Donald Trump, of the two things, one was effectively diaries. And to even get there, Robert Hur was using a double standard. He was like, right. Well, Reagan's were diaries, but because you're Joe Biden, yours are notebooks.
Right.
And under the law, even if you take your classified notes home, they're still classified documents.
Right.
But DOJ, going back a half century, going back to when these rules were put in place, has treated presidential and vice presidential diaries differently, consistently, including Reagan's, but not just Reagan's. And so, this is what I think Jack, in the reports I saw of the hearing, Jack Smith didn't say clearly enough, which was like, look, you know, Joe Biden brought diaries home. You're not a diary keeper. So, and we didn't charge you for any diaries. As far as we know, there's only maybe one that isn't like a formal document, a formal report that was put in front of the president.
Right.
And so, you know, those diaries fall under personal records. And by law, this is something that probably needs to be tightened in the Presidential Records Act. But by law, Joe Biden is allowed to bring it home. So he really did believe he was allowed to bring home those documents, whereas Donald Trump brought home a bunch of actual classified documents with it's important. Like, there's probably hundreds more notes that Trump took when he was in a briefing. He wasn't charged for any of those.
Right. Right.
He was only charged for other things. Like, there's at least There's a nuclear document in there. He can't declassify that by himself. And so that one, you know, should have been outside of the discussion. It wasn't. It, you know, it's a testament to how poorly run the discussion was. But anyway, so argument happens. Aileen Cannon says, you know, go back and pretend that the Presidential Records Act says something different and write jury instructions for how it works. And this is when Jack Smith said, you know, if you do this, I'm going to mandamus you. And Aileen Cannon said in a 3-page opinion. So far, like, her opinions on these motions to dismiss total are maybe 5 pages, maybe 6 uh-huh. pages. Like, normally, you know, I've been covering a Hunter Biden one this week. That was an 82-page opinion from the judge in California. So 82 pages, you know, most of it very well thought out. This is a judge who doesn't want to be reversed on these issues, except for, you know, I think he did a couple of things that were stupid. But Aileen Cannon, she doesn't care. That she's not doing, and this is something that I probably will write about as well. It's like, why is she writing only 3-page opinions on stuff? And one possible reason why is she's going to revisit it, right? Like, so she didn't rule out the possibility that Trump can use as a defense that he, you know, that Tom Fitton retroactively helped him declassify a bunch of stuff that he stuck on a truck and sent to Mar-a-Lago. So that's where we're at. You know, I think that nothing is going to happen immediately because Jack Smith is not in a strong enough position to be able to say she did something unreasonable. Like, I think it is more likely if Aileen Cannon orders, as she has said she might, the identity of a witness who's being stalked. I think it's more likely that if she orders that, then Jack Smith will respond to that to do one of these two things, mandamus or move to recuse her.
Okay, but what's the difference? Is mandamus just get her reprimanded by the court for not what does mandamus do?
Mandamus basically goes above her head. So in this case, it'd be to the 11th Circuit. As I said, Jack Smith had tremendous success with the 11th Circuit in 2022. They were horrified by what Judge Cannon had done, and it was the same theory. Like, the reason Aileen Cannon said Donald Trump could review all of these documents before prosecutors got it, she said, is because there were a few personal records in there. And there had to be a fight about what was personal and what actually belonged to the government. Same theory. She's still adhering to the same theory. The 11th Circuit didn't like it the first time. There's no reason that they would like it more the second time. I mean, even SCOTUS, it went to SCOTUS. SCOTUS wasn't impressed either. But the problem is, and this is the problem, you know, like, I think a lot of TV lawyers aren't setting expectations for this well enough, is for Jack Smith to succeed, he needs to be in a posture where he can appeal. I mean, like, the same thing is going on in the Hunter Biden case. Like, I think that Judge Scarcy, Mark Scarcy, Trump appointee, Los Angeles judge, who kind of jumped the gun, mm-hmm. he should have waited for the Delaware judge to rule first. She may rule the same way. Like, that, you know, there is a justifiable reason to rule the way that it's just weird. But he ruled, and because of the kind of challenge it was, Hunter Biden's not going to be able to appeal that until he's found guilty. Wow. You know, so he's going to be, and, you know, and I think, like, the tax case is fairly, there are parts of the tax case that are fairly strong against him. I mean, Abby Lowell is a tremendously good lawyer, but you know, the prosecutors have done a million things to kind of gimmick it into place such that they can take the weak parts out of it. And so, you know, I think it is not, you know, if I'm Abby Lowell and I'm faced with that, if Judge Noriega, the Delaware judge, does the same thing, then if I'm Abby Lowell, I'm in the same position Jack Smith is, which is, how can I get this into a posture where I can appeal? Because I think that the decision was very wrongly decided, given precedents about plea bargains and diversion agreements. So, you know, this is something that I think needs to be explained about the law all the time. Jack Smith is not in the position to do anything about Aileen Cannon. So all of the kind of chatter about we're going to get rid of Aileen Cannon this week ain't going to happen. It's just not. And, it's just not.
Okay, but so in her 3-page order, in response to Jack Smith's much longer I don't know. I don't know the legalese, but the document that he filed last week in response to her asking both sides for what kind of jury instructions they would give as to whether or not the Presidential Records Act actually benefited Trump in this, which it doesn't. It's just so convoluted. And he challenged her on this and basically said, you need to spell out what it is that's going on here. And I hope you'll restate what I'm saying so clumsily. But so in this 3-page order, she denies Trump's motion to dismiss the superseding indictment based on the Presidential Records Act. And so she says no. And then in this same 3-page document, she sends a message to Jack Smith, which, and again, I don't read a lot of legal documents, so I could be totally off base here, Marcy, and you tell me. But I read this. Here's it directly read from the filing. Separately, to the extent the special counsel demands an anticipatory finalization of jury instructions prior to trial, prior to a charge conference, and prior to the presentation of trial defenses and evidence, the court declines that demand as unprecedented and unjust. Excuse me. The court's order soliciting preliminary draft instructions on certain counts should not be misconstrued as declaring a final definition on any essential element or asserted defense in this case, nor should it be interpreted as anything other than what it was, a genuine attempt in the context of the upcoming trial to better understand the parties' competing positions and the questions to be submitted to the jury in this complex case of first impression. And then she adds, as always, any party remains free to avail itself of whatever appellate options it sees fit to invoke as permitted by law. Was this unusually snarky or her saying to Jack Smith, I can ask for whatever I want and screw you, you'll do what I say. And if you want to appeal it, go, good luck to you.
Yeah. I mean, that's, I think, a really good summary of what she said. She has said similar things before. I mean, she has been cranky since she got embarrassingly reversed by the 11th Circuit. And, you know, it's not outside the realm of possibility that one of her motives going on is to avenge that, to find some way to screw Jack Smith over for embarrassing her so early in her judicial career.
Wow.
And, you know, that wouldn't surprise me in the least. Judges tend to be very persnickety and they tend to be thin skinned because they're judges. They don't have to answer to anybody. They're life appointed judges. And so yeah, she was basically telling Jack Smith to fuck off and that she is the judge here and he's not.
Right.
And she's not. So normally what happens is in advance of a trial, so like 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and, you know, 2 months before a trial, depending on how complex this is, both sides submit what are called motions in limine. I'm not pronouncing that right because I never do. But but they're basically like, let's set the ground rules for the trial before it starts, rather than doing this all while the jury's there. And right. Some of them are like one thing that will be the case in this case, and frankly, in the Hunter Biden case as well, is prosecutors will say, you're not allowed to say that this case came about for political reasons. And in both cases, that's going to succeed. It shouldn't in the Hunter Biden case, but it doesn't matter. That always succeeds in these cases, like it happened in the John Durham case as well. There will be arguments about whether Trump can claim, I mean, in this case, Jack Smith is going to say, Aileen Cannon, I want you to prohibit Donald Trump from claiming that he declassified this or for claiming that the Presidential Records Act allowed him to do this. And there's going to be the same fight at this time. And often these fights go into the start of the trial. That's normal, right? Mm-hmm. So you're still mm-hmm. fighting about what rules are, you know, they'll go a couple days into the trial. But once a jury is seated in this trial, if it ever gets to trial, then double jeopardy prohibits Jack Smith from getting another shot at this. And that's why everyone's so concerned. That's why people are saying, Jack Smith, you need to do something pretty rash, like mandamus, because it, you know, she looks prepped. And I think that that order was consistent with her being prepped to doing something like that, to basically getting to the trial and telling the jury, sure, if Donald Trump says he owns these because he's the former president.
And then at that point, it's too late. The damage is done and there's nothing he can do about it. So he's trying to get this all clarified beforehand, which is that normal operating procedure?
Well, I think, look, the request itself for jury, the request itself was completely abnormal.
Right. At this point,
she was basically saying, let's have make believe, and let's make believe that the law says something entirely different, and let's have a make believe and think about what the trial would look like if the law said something totally different. You're not supposed to do that as a judge. Right. But it is, you know, this isn't like Jack Smith. Same thing. He tried with Supreme Court. He went to them and he said, please, can you review this immunity claim now?
Right.
This was in December. Can you review this immunity claim now? And the Supreme Court gave Donald Trump an additional 4 months of delay,
right,
which is how the D.C. case may not happen before the election. And that's the thing about judges. And that's the thing about partisan hack judges. And that's this is the reality, and this is the reality of charging the first president ever. And I think it's important why it's one reason why it's important to have state cases, you know, like Fannie Willis is in trouble in Georgia as well. Although Donald Trump's effort to throw that case out on a First Amendment grounds failed. Mm-hmm. He's doing this in all of his cases. He's like, it's just me, you know, lying through my teeth all the time, and I'm allowed to do that. With somebody like Donald Trump, you just need as much surface area as you possibly can get.
Of course, because he doesn't play by any of the rules. He thinks he's above it all. But I got to ask you, because it seems that he did something else this week that should get the Judge Cannon taken off the case. He sent out a post on his Truth Social that reads, Judge Cannon, a great patriot and fine judge, made an excellent decision in our case against corrupt and loony Jack Smith and his dirty tactics. Not since King David has a judge adjudicated a more wise decision. When I win, again, I never lost. I will make Judge Cannon a Supreme Court justice as soon as vacancy is made. I will remake the Supreme Court so that these witch hunts by corrupt men will never happen again in our great country. MAGA! He just said, she's doing my bidding, and if I get back into office, she will be my next Supreme Court nominee the first time a seat opens up. Doesn't that raise eyebrows?
Yeah, it does. And I have said before, and, you know, I'm sort of lonely on this, but I have said before that based on how the immunity argument comes out at Supreme Court, you could see Donald Trump charged for things he did as president. One of those things is corrupt pardons. What he did with Aileen Cannon is not much different from corrupt pardons. He was in discussions, or at least Roger Stone was in discussions, and maybe even Don Jr., with Julian Assange no later than 15 days after the 2016 election. And I think it actually started around October 3rd. So before the John Podesta emails came out,
right,
there's already this discussion about Trump pardoning Julian Assange. So in addition to the, like, Paul Manafort, Roger Stone, Steve Bannon, if you lie for me, I'll pardon you quid pro quos, there's this Assange one that never gets enough attention, which really did happen, where even before he was president, so similar to the Aileen Cannon thing, even before he was president, he was offering to do something as president for a benefit now. Right, because it's not, like, if I'm right that these pardon discussions started in October 2016, then this discussion started before the John Podesta files dumped.
Right.
And it is not yet clear when and how you can prosecute that. Is that a bribe to a judge? We'll see, right? We'll see. And would that make a recusal case easier? Yeah. But it's not enough for the recusal case yet. And I think that what an interesting thing, by the way, is like, of course, Donald Trump and all of his flunkies are arguing that any non-Trump judge presiding over his case, must be recused.
Right.
Or at least any Democratic appointed judge must be recused. Yep. He did this with Trudkin, right?
Yep.
And he's doing it. These are the attacks that he's launching against Merchant. Merchant's daughter has some tie to Democratic.
Right. And now apparently he's going after Merchant's wife.
Yeah. Daughter, right?
Well, now after hitting on the daughter, now I just saw a headline. I honestly didn't read the whole thing, but see, his next focus of his attacks is Merchant's wife.
Huh. Well, I guess there you go.
Yeah. So he learns nothing from it's like he thumbs his nose at the judiciary. He's like, OK, yeah, you give me these gag orders. Do something about it. Let's see you try to enforce it. That's the problem, because I guess they could fine him or they could jail him. But they don't seem to be doing anything.
Well, look, I mean, fining him makes sense because it is something that you can do. Jailing him, I mean, the other thing that's going on, and people need to understand this, right, is when Angoron was presiding over the Trump case, there was a point where he had gotten far enough into the case where he was just like, I'm going to go get through this trial without doing anything to be reversed.
Uh-huh.
And that's the kind of mindset of judges. And so one of the things you're seeing from judges, which I think, again, isn't being explained well enough, is that, first of all, it's going to be hard to make the case that you have to jail somebody who's got Secret Service protection full time, because a lot of the argument, like, is Trump viably going to flee? And sure, he's got his private plane, but he's also accompanied by law enforcement all the time. And this is the kind of I'm not saying that it'll never happen, but this is the kind of discussion that you're going to have. If he continues to escalate, and if it comes to jailing him, I think that certainly, it's not impossible that DOJ and their, DOJ is not supposed to have this much influence on Jack Smith. But I think that if you're Jack Smith, if you're DOJ, you really don't want to get into a confrontation where you're going to jail a presidential candidate. No. And Trump knows this, right?
Yep.
And so it's not unreasonable to take the stance for both judges and for DOJ to take the stance that they've taken so far, because it is a way to get to trial. Whereas if you jail Trump, it's not clear you're going to get to trial. You're going to turn the trial into something that's not about Donald Trump's conduct.
Right.
And you're going to make Clarence Thomas more likely to reverse. Right. So these are all the calculations that judges will make. And, it sucks because everyone's like, look, he's inciting violence left and right. And by the way, like, the incitement is really hard to bring back to Donald Trump. In John Eastman's disbarment recommendation last week, the one charge that didn't stick is the charge that he helped to incite the attack on the Capitol.
Wow.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things that's happening is the things that people are like, oh, it's so easy to charge that. For example, one of the charges that was thrown out in Georgia is the call to Raffensperger. That's no longer on the table. And we all look at it and it's like, it's so obvious what he was doing. But the way, that's where intent gets tricky. That's where proving an effect gets tricky. And I, from everything I know about Jack Smith's January 6th case, he has done so many things to be able to prove that Trump had a tie to the actual riot. And those things, people people don't have a concept. I mean, I've told this before, but I think it's really cool, so I'm going to tell it again. Okay. Like, one of the things that they did early on when they were investigating the rioters, they got what's called a geofence, right? Mm-hmm. So they went to Facebook, they went to Google, they went to the cell phone companies, and they said, preserve all of the metadata for the people who were at the Capitol, all the location data. And the Google one has been particularly useful. What they've done is tell me what phones have pinged Google from the location. And they started with just inside the Capitol, and then they expanded it slightly to the Capitol plus the kind of the fights around the doors. Mm-hmm. And then they expanded it to there was a area that was restricted, and they had the barriers up and they had signs and it was illegal to be there. And so they got the Google pings of all the people who triggered Google, mm-hmm. which is about a third of the people who were there. And then what they did afterwards is they went to Google and said, give us, I don't know how they did it yet. I'm a geek for this stuff, so I'm actually looking forward to it. What they probably did is they said, okay, here are the identifiers of people that we know ended up in the restricted space. Mm-hmm. Tell us who was at the Ellipse for Trump's speech. And so one of the things that this thing ever gets to trial is going to be this super cool graphic,
right?
By my account, there's at least 10,000 people that they're going to show were sitting there at Trump's speech. And after he ordered them to go to the Capitol, Google has them walking to the Capitol. And right. then DOJ is going to be able to say, and that's what this person, I mean, one of the people likely is going to be Danny Rodriguez, the guy who tased Michael Fanone and almost killed him. Like I'm quite confident of, they are going to show, because they've already done this, like they are going to show Danny Rodriguez at the speech. And after Trump said, you got to go to the Capitol and take the country back, there's a documentary film guy there, and he turns to the camera and he goes like this, Joe Biden, this. So you can see, like, he responds directly to Trump's incitement, or actually might have even been Rudy's. And then he makes a threat against Joe Biden. And then he goes to the Capitol, all the while saying, we have to go after Mike Pence. We have to go after Mike Pence, you know, so responding to Trump. And then what does he do? He almost murders Michael Fanone. And they're going to show that. That's going to be one of the things they show. They're going to show Trump's relationship with the Proud Boys. But this is the stuff that, you know, literally DOJ has been doing for years, that most people don't understand how long it takes. I mean, like the Google fence stuff, the stuff I know about, which is only getting the Google identifications for the people who were in the restricted grounds, that took, I want to say, 7 months.
Yeah, too long.
It's a big back and forth. It's a complex, and then they have to go back to Google again. So, you know, just that process, getting the Google identifiers from people who listened to Donald Trump and then walked to the Capitol in response, that probably took 9 months of some group of FBI agents' time. Really cool application. I'm sure Donald Trump, I mean, he hasn't challenged it yet, but I'm sure Donald Trump is going to challenge it from a Fourth Amendment perspective. And then DOJ is going to say, sorry, it's not your Fourth Amendment. You know, like, you're not those people. Those people already had their opportunity to challenge. Anyway, that's what I'm, you know, like, this is the kind of work it takes to prove actual incitement.
Right.
You know, they've been able to show association before, but they haven't been able to show, you know, it's really hard to show, even with Tyler Toronto. I'm not sure if I've talked about him on the show. Tyler Toronto is still one of the people in the DC jail that there's a lot of focus on because Donald Trump is talking about pardoning him. So mentally disturbed. I want to say he was in the Navy. So PTSD, they knew he was disturbed. He goes to the Capitol. If I'm remembering correctly, what he did at the Capitol was just the kind of normal trespassing, and maybe rioting, but not a high priority defendant, right? Because he wasn't that dangerous at the Capitol. But then after he wasn't prosecuted yet, and he kept coming back to DC, and he was participating in this like fan club for the jailed January Sixers. And then one day Donald Trump puts Barack Obama's address on Truth Social.
That's right. I remember that.
So this guy is mentally ill. Donald Trump puts Barack Obama's address on Truth Social. And so this guy drives in his van. This is not the only thing he did, but he drives in his van to Kalorama with explosives in the van and starts stalking the neighborhood. And at this point, of course, the Secret Service are like, hold your horses. But that's as close as we can get to Donald Trump doing something that led to incitement. That guy is still being prosecuted. They've added, you know, they've only just recently been to the point where, you know, again, this all takes a lot of time, but they've only just been recently to the point where the charges for having those weapons, he launched a Fourth Amendment challenge to the search of the van that found them. And so now that prosecution is in place where it might settle or something like that. But again, you've got to do all of that before you could ever hold Donald Trump responsible for it. And it's not clear in this case whether they can even do that. I mean, you know, again, many of the people, there was another guy, Ricky Schiffer, who in the wake of Donald Trump's the search of Mar-a-Lago, he tried to invade the Cincinnati FBI office. There's another guy, Atlanta, this week. He was another Trump fan. We still don't know that much about him, but, you know, these cases, it's really hard to prove that Donald Trump was the but-for that led these people to attack the FBI. You know, we've got such a large number of them at this point that, you know, eventually there may be the case, right? But they're just really hard. I mean, there was Cesar Sosa. I'm going to pronounce his name wrong.
Yeah, he was in Florida. How could I forget? And he was found with pipe bombs and so was prosecuted. But I want to, before we move on from the whole Judge Cannon mess, who's...
I distracted you for like a good 40 minutes, didn't I?
whose court is the ball in now? So the last thing was from Judge Cannon basically saying, fuck you to Jack Smith. You want to appeal this? Go for it. So is it up to Jack Smith now to file something and say...
Yeah, and like I said, I don't think he'll do that in response to this per se. I think he'll wait on a few more decisions. If people aren't already, I really, really recommend they follow Roger Parloff at Lawfare.
Okay.
And Lawfare is doing some fundraising specifically tied to their Trump coverage. Anna Bauer is also superb on anything Atlanta-based.
Yes.
But Roger is, to my mind, one of the best detailed journalists on these legal cases. And one of the things that I wanted to do, I was like, I should do that. It's going to take a lot of work. Well, Roger did this. What he did is he took, because one of the things Cannon is doing is, for a variety of reasons, the stuff that should immediately show on the docket isn't there. So, for example, there are all these motions to dismiss, including the selective prosecution one, that because they included sensitive information, aren't public yet. And it was, you know, an asinine decision on her part, but in effect, it has created this cloud around what is actually going on in the docket. Roger has a list of that.
Wow.
He's posted it a couple times on Twitter. I think his Twitter address is rparloff. Let me see if I can find him, because it's really worth looking at. So it's rparloff, Roger Parloff, two Fs.
Okay.
And he's just got a list of everything that we don't know, that's still pending, that we don't know about.
Cool.
Right. And so that'll help people understand some of the other things that are still out there that might be the trigger for Jack Smith to go try and recuse her. And again, you know, like I don't think this order the other day is going to be that trigger, because it's not the best posture. I mean, this is what you do as a lawyer. Like trial lawyering is as much about tactics as it is anything else. So
sure.
I think Jack Smith is probably in conversations about how can we tactically get this before the 11th Circuit such that we have a chance in hell of winning, because it's really not hard. It's not easy to win a mandamus. It's not easy to win a recusal. Both the standards for those is you know, close to impossibly high. And so people should have the expectation that she's going to remain on the case. Like, maybe he'll find a way, but people honestly should have the expectation that she's going to be on the case for the foreseeable future.
Well, that kind of sucks, because again, the warnings from the, as you call them, the TV lawyers, is that this could, you know, she'll make this ruling. Once the trial begins, nothing can be done. And she can just say, sure, the Presidential Records Act applies here, when it really does not. And Jack Smith has no recourse, because by that time the trial has begun and he can appeal no matter what happens. It would invoke double jeopardy.
Yeah. No, I mean, the TV lawyers are right about that. It's not just TV lawyers who are saying that. I think TV lawyers are not setting appropriate expectations for how difficult winning a mandamus or winning a recusal motion would be. And that's all I'm trying to say, is that you can't snap your fingers and Aileen Cannon will be gone, I promise.
Now, could Merrick Garland do anything as the guy who runs the Justice Department?
No, Merrick Garland has no day-to-day role in this case, never did. And no matter what, I mean, this is a fundamental part of due process. You have independent judges, and Merrick Garland can't call somebody up and say, do something. The judges are there to be independent of DOJ. That is their purpose. So DOJ has to persuade a judge somewhere, and it sure as hell not going to be Aileen Cannon herself,
right,
to do something about this. But they first have to find a way to get before a judge. Again, like, same thing with Hunter Biden. I think he probably has a good case on appeal that this immunity, that he is immune from these prosecutions, but he's not going to be able to get before a judge until he's found guilty. That's just the way it works.
Right.
And so it means, I mean, it sucks, but that's the way it works.
It's all so complicated. Marcy Wheeler is with us, as she is on Fridays, trying to help us make some sense of it all. So you mentioned Anna Bauer, who does great work covering all this stuff as well. And she shitted something out today. There was an earthquake in the Northeast that hit just west of New York City. And she determined that the epicenter was Trump's Bedminster Golf Club, which it probably was pretty close. Just weirdness, more weirdness, as if we needed more weirdness to, you know, to help end this week.
Yeah, I mean, and there's going to be some disinformation about that, so people should be very cautious about how they chase that. Oh, look, I think the more interesting stuff going on with Donald Trump is financial, right? Like, two of three guys who were prosecuted for insider trading on the original social setup pled guilty this week. No sign of cooperation from them, but they had ties to this Russian dude, who porn funder, who kind of floated. There was a Roger Sullenberger article in the Daily Beast, in any case, but describing how this porn funder kept True Social afloat for a little while.
Right.
So that's there. And then another key issue is Donald Trump's bond for the Tish James case. So 100 and however many
$75 million, right?
That guy, you have to be normally to provide the bond for somebody in New York State. There's a list, like, you have to meet certain standards. And the guy who's doing this, another kind of dodgy character, he's like he's a loan shark for cars, basically. And so he said, sure, Donald, I'll do that. And then, you know, started submitting the paperwork to do it. That wasn't properly filled in. They had to come back and do it again. And Tish James rightly said, look, he doesn't qualify. He doesn't have the liquidity to put up this bond, because when I come looking for that $100 million, I need to be able to get it. And this dude doesn't have it. And so this guy, who's got a, you know, somewhat shady business to begin with, is now going to have to start turning over paperwork to Tish James, if that's going to be the bond that Donald Trump has. So he's got a bit of time to do that. But, you know, all of these financial things are adding up. And then True Social, meanwhile, went public.
Yes.
But has already lost a good chunk of its value and will continue to kind of trickle away value. And every day that happens, that's, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars of Donald Trump's ostensible net worth that goes out the door. So it's, you know, the financial stuff has the ability to snowball. And I don't think that, you know, I always think that I'd love 30 years from now, 50 years from now, there are going to be these great accounts of how Donald Trump survived or didn't survive that are going to read like a James Clavell novel. The family has meetings that only the family is part of and talks about the desperate things they're going to do to stay afloat, to live another day, because they are, the Trump family has been doing this for decades, right? We've been through bankruptcies already. And that has to be going on, but it's not being leaked to the press. And so we're not going to find out about it for, you know, probably a decade at least. But they're like, on top of what we see, there has to be a real desperation in the Trump camp, because his finances have the ability to just crumble. You know, any other person in his situation would declare bankruptcy. That's what Alex Jones did. That's what Rudy Giuliani did. He can't do that. That's, you know, that's not how you win an election as a president. And, you know, and meanwhile, like all of these people who invested in Truth Social, who did it because they're MAGAs, are losing money hand over fist. And
right.
So,
and they're going to keep losing money. And a lot of those people probably, you know, don't know the ins and outs of investing in the stock market. They're doing it because they're Trumpers and maggots. And they think, oh, this is what I'm supposed to do. Meanwhile, they're going to lose their life savings.
And more people defrauded by Donald Trump. And so
it goes on and on and on. Now, you mentioned the this porn financier, owner of a bank in the Caribbean named Anton Postolnikov. Did I read something that he's somehow connected to Alexander Smirnov?
Different Alexander. Smirnov, like Joe Smith. He's connected to somebody else named the equivalent of Russian Joe Smith. But that Russian Joe Smith has ties to Putin. So
of course he does.
He is an interesting character, and keep, you know, like we're just learning aspects of that, of his role in Truth Social now. So we'll see.
You know, it's amazing that the Truth Social going public, first of all, merging with this other company, and then going public with a ridiculous declared valuation. You know, I keep seeing clips of Kevin O'Leary, the guy from Shark Tank, who always tells people that their valuation is nuts, and in stronger terms than that. And he defends Donald Trump. How do they defend this valuation when last year, I think their revenue total was like $4 million, but their losses were over $60 million. And they still have a valuation in the billions?
Yeah, and people should read Josh Marshall. He did an interesting thing. Because Josh Marshall knows, I think, better than just about anybody, because he's kept a medium-sized independent, you know, outlet floating.
Talking Points Memo. Right.
And so he has some interesting things about, like, what Donald Trump's worth should be, because it should be about the same as his own sites, because there just aren't that many people on Truth Social. They don't get signups. I got a fucking blue check this week, Nicole.
I know, I was going to ask you about that. That's my next thing on the list. So you wake up yesterday morning, and there's a blue check next to you now on the current incarnation of Elmo's shitter. You have to pay a ridiculous amount of money for those blue checks. Now, we had them before. They were taken away from us.
I never
had one.
No, so I'm a new virgin blue check forced on me by Elon Musk.
See, I had one in the old incarnation, and I don't, but I noticed after I saw yours and you going, what the, you know, bullshit, this is bullshit. By the way, nice mention in the Washington Post that you have a potty mouth. Thank you so much.
I know that was, people should look, that Will Arimus wrote that one. He's like, I'm sort of interested that you got this. And, you know, we talked a bit about what I think Elon Musk is up to. I mean, like, it's fascist washing, you know, like what Elon Musk wants to do with the site is to do what they were very successful in doing in 2016 and successful, but moderation limited in 2020, which is to use it sort of as an assignment editor for dumb mainstream media journalists. In other words, like, and they would do this. Douglas Mackey, who is, as we speak, his appeal is being heard by the Second Circuit. He's the guy who tweeted out stuff and got people to text the vote rather than actually
Yes.
So his appeal is literally as we're speaking before the Second Circuit right now. But they were very professional about the way, you know, they'd wake up and they'd get something trending so that New York Times would report on it. They knew how to manipulate the New York Times. They knew how to manipulate CNN. They laughed at them. And I think the reason Elmo is doing this is reinstalling the blue checks is partly to hide the degree to which the only people with blue checks, the only people paying for blue checks, are Nazis or Nazi equivalents.
Right.
And then he also, I think, wants to stop the drain of people to other sites. And so for people who rely on Twitter to get readership, this puts them back at the top of the slot again. So, so yeah, I was fortified. I got a blue check. It took me a little while. For those who have one, you have to, like, I had to go on the app rather than on the browser.
Okay.
To take the badge of shame off my site, but it's there secretly.
Oh, so, but we don't see it next to your name now. But I did notice a number of people who I know are high profile who would never pay for a blue check on Shitter. And they all, like you, they showed up yesterday. And I was like, okay, well, I didn't make the grade. Thank goodness. It's one less thing I need to deal with. But a lot of them. So you got yours at least not visible on the site, but others are still like, why do I have this thing? I don't want it.
Right. And honestly, you know, like I don't rely on Twitter for my readership.
Right.
I mean, I'm sure I get readers there. I'm sure it's useful, but like, you know, a lot of what I do on Twitter is to go make fun of people like Stephen Miller. A lot of what I do on Twitter is to go monitor what traditional journalists are saying about dick pic snipping or about how they're miscovering some of these cases or, you know, and I, you know, like the thing about Twitter being such a hellhole is I don't feel the same obligations to be civil because it's not a civil site.
It is not.
Right. Like,
right.
This is like counter meaning. This is like, how can I make Stephen Miller's stupid bullshit claims about migrants look absurd so that the journalists who remain on the site have a harder time treating him as a normal human being, which of course he's not.
No, he's not. No, I agree. Look, I'm still there because I don't want to turn it over to them. So I'll keep posting my shit on there and fighting with trolls, which I do, and I've got a potty mouth just like you do. And I don't worry about it. Like it used to be, you'd get the warning. Are you sure you want to respond like this? Yeah, fuck you, I do. Now, absolutely I do. I don't care. What are you going to do, ban me from the site? You don't ban Nazis. Go ahead and ban me.
Right. I mean, it's not a place that I enjoy. Like every once in a while, I'll be typing like that. And my spouse will come by and he's like, are you mad at somebody on Twitter? I'm like, no, I'm being an asshole on Twitter. Like, yes. Yeah, I am. And he calls me out for it. And but honestly, it's like, it's not a pleasant place. It's not a place, but it's like, it's not that I, you know, it's the, you know, the Nazis need to be aware that they're being seen. The dumb maggots need to be aware that what they're doing is not socially acceptable. And that's some of what I try and do on the site, which is to like make that stuff visible so that it's not, I mean, you know, and some of it goes back to covering the Douglas Mackey trial. I saw how they worked. I wish everyone could read Microchip's testimony about how he gamed the New York Times on a daily basis during 2016, because he was smarter than they are. And he's still smarter. He and his associates are still smarter than journalists who still will write about what somebody says as if it is news without thinking about how they're just mainstreaming fascism. But the fascists are doing it intentionally. They are doing it with purpose. And so, you know, that process needs to be made visible.
Yeah. And you do a great job of calling out the so-called journalists who are, you know, they just are take down dictation, I guess, and spit out what their access people would have them report so that they can keep the access. I'm sure I'm oversimplifying it, but yeah. And you do a great job of calling them out, because there are a number of people at the Heritage media outlets who are lazy journalists, if you can call them journalists. There's some do good reporting, but unfortunately, there's too many who don't, and you do call them out. So thank you.
Whatever.
All right. Well, we're getting to the end of the hour, so we can wrap it up here. Now, next week, you'll be here, but you may be out of your home in Dublin or something, but we'll figure out. We'll make it work.
Yeah, I won't. I will not be tuning in from my home. So I might, you know, be in some swank Airbnb or something, or maybe I'll do it from, I'll have Kirkpatrick in the background.
Okay.
I'll have some really cool, I'll do it from a cafe and it'll be crazy, but we won't. I'll take a picture of Kirkpatrick and put it as my background. And then I'll look really, serve tourism for Westport.
Very Ireland. Nice. Very nice. Yep. Never been, one of these years, maybe. Marcy Wheeler, again, as always, find her at emptywheel.net and go please support her work, because she's not behind a paywall and she, this is her livelihood. So do support that work so we can keep taking advantage of it. I'll see you. I'll see you next week, and I'll see you at Empty Wheel, and I'll see you on the shitters.
Take care. Have a good week.
You too. Marcy Wheeler. And with that, we reach the end of the hour. I have 2 minutes left. I thought I would let her go and for once not run over, so that our friends who listen on progressivevoices.com and the other online stations that carry the show, they don't get cut off in midstream. So again, wrapping up the week, what a week it was. We could all use the weekend. Let's tell you what's going on next week. I've got an interview that I recorded, I don't know, last week or the week before. The book will be out next week, and it's by a guy named Norman Ohler. It's called Tripped: Nazi Germany, the CIA, and the Dawn of the Psychedelic Age. Now, if you've been listening for a while, you know that I deal with depression, and I dabbled in ketamine therapy. I'm very interested in the use of psychedelics for mental health treatment. So it's a fascinating interview. The book reads like a movie script. So we've got that on, Tuesday. Monday, of course, Jonathan Larson from the fucking news will tell us what happened over the weekend, and we'll figure out what else to, to talk about. Oh, I'm sorry, Durbin. I just looked over and saw Durbin, one of the regulars in the chat room, whose younger brother passed away. We've talked about this too. As we get older, this is what happens. It's all around us. Quick update on the foot for anybody interested in the saga that I told you about yesterday. I'm still waiting on the blood work. I do not think that I have gout. I still have a hard time saying that. I don't think I have gout. I do think, I don't know. I don't know what it is, but I'll know for sure when the blood work results get here, whenever that might be. I did take prednisone last night. That took down the swelling. It helped with the pain. I'm feeling much better, except it kept me awake literally all night. So I'm going to end this show. I'm going to post the podcast, and I'm going to try to take a nap, because, going all night with no sleep is really difficult. And here we are at the end of another week. A big thanks to Marcy Wheeler, as always. Thanks to you for listening, for, bearing with the gremlins here and everything else that goes along with the fun. Until next week, thank you. And a quick notice, I'm working on a website. I've been, creating new things that will all be for sale, and maybe, hopefully, at some point next week or the following week, hopefully I'll have something to share with you. Okay. All right. I'm going to go sleep and then have a weekend. So I hope you will too. Sleep, that's up to you, but do have the weekend. and I will see you Monday. Have a good one. Peace out.